like today, I often ask myself, Lizzie, why in the name of a one-horse open sleigh are you so busy baking Christmas bread when you run a cupcake business? Well, every year I like to mix things up a little bit, and I always make an exception for these little beauties. So, why Christmas bread? Well, I've been told that my Christmas bread is the confectionery manifestation of heaven. Does it sound like I'm bragging? I really don't mean to. It's just what I've been told. And after all, baking contest blue ribbons don't lie. But there is one thing that I will never, ever bake in my cupcake shop. For it is a horrible, treacherous Christmas abomination. Fruitcake. I mean, first of all, no. And second of all, just no. I mean, does it even need to be said? You either want fruit or cake. And I personally do not want both at the same time. I mean, you might as well make a drink called orange toothpaste juice. Anywho, I learned the art of baking from my mama. Every year, Mama would bake these very loaves of Christmas bread, then she'd wrap them up in beautiful little packages and stack them up as high as our Christmas tree. Then I'd get to go out with her and deliver them door to door to all the neighbors. Oh, how they loved to see her coming. Especially our neighbor, Mrs. June. Sweetest little old lady. She liked to talk to mailboxes. Anyway, when baking for others, Mama always taught us to pray for each and every person that we were baking for. I know, this Christmas bread ain't probably gonna change somebody's life forever. But who knows? After all, big things do come from little places. Like my Aunt Lucy, big hair, tiny woman. She drove an 18-wheeler till she was 82. If you look in your rearview mirror, all you'll see is two knuckles and a big bouffant. And, like, take Bethlehem, for instance. No one knew a thing about that little old place until Jesus came and blew the doors right off of it. Oh, listen to this. I learned in church that there are actually two Bethlehems in Israel. Now, the one where Jesus was born in the south is called Bethlehem Ephrata. The word Bethlehem means house of bread. And the word Ephrata means fruitful. So altogether, the place where Jesus was born is called the Fruitful House of Bread. Now, I just want to say this is not a biblical reference to fruitcake. This is fruit bread. There is a large difference. Fruitcake is better suited to anchor a boat than to usher in the birth of a king. So, let's not get all caught up in the holly jolliness of gift giving without really receiving the main gift or the main ingredient. Now, if I were to forget the main ingredient, I mean, we'd have a Christmas calamity on our hands. I mean, like this sugar here. If I were to forget the sugar, oh, well, I'll be a snowflake in July. I have been substituting the salt for the sugar all this time, folks. Oh, I have made something worse than fruitcake. Oh. But the message is that isn't it great that little old Bethlehem was chosen to be the place where God's Son, the biggest gift in a tiny body, would draw his very first human breath. And what a perfect, perfect recipe for mankind. Jesus Christ, the bread of life. Amen? Amen. Thank you, guys.
Hello, my name's Lewis, and I love Christmas. It's my favorite time of the year. From the lights, the snow, the decorations, but most importantly, I love the reason for the season. So this year, being a Christian, I decided that I've had enough of hearing people use that disrespectful phrase. You know the one I'm talking about. Happy holidays. Every time I would hear someone say it, I'd throw a good old Merry Christmas back in their faces. Booyah for the Messiah! Ow, ooh, ooh.
Stop getting riled up. You're gonna hurt yourself.
Mom, I'm trying to talk here.
Whatever. I'm calling Dr. Goldstein.
Sorry about that. I had to move in with my mother after all of this.
Tell the truth, sweetie.
Fine. Fine. I've always lived with my mother.
Against my better judgment.
Mom, can I just tell my story? Anyways. So the other day, I go to the grocery store to get some eggnog. And I walk in and the guy by the grocery carts lays a "Happy Holidays, Mister" on me like it's no big deal. But you know what?
What, honey?
Mom! It was rhetorical. I'm building the drama to the story.
Always so dramatic.
I'm the dramatic one? Anyways, this kid, this Happy Holidays punk, just riled me up. So I shake it off, I go, I grab the nog, and I go out to pay. And while I'm at the checkout counter, the clerk says to me, "Happy Holidays." And I'm enraged. It was a blind fury. I mean, I jumped on top of the checkout counter, I grabbed the microphone, and I began to yell in it. I yelled, "It's not just a holiday, people. It's Christmas!" I'm mad as heck at this point. I'm not gonna take it anymore. And unfortunately, at that moment, my foot set off the motion sensor for the conveyor belt. A nice, soft loaf of bread or a small little carton of orange juice doesn't look like it's moving very fast when it's on the belt. But when a 230-pound man comes flying off that belt, and fly I did, not like a majestic eagle soaring through the air or like Superman going to save Lois Lane, no. It was more like a partridge falling off its pear tree. And I flew right through the air, right into a display of Chia Pet nativity sets, thus my current condition. And then something unexpected happened. I received a gift in the mail. Mom, a little help here. Well, at first I didn't know who it was from. And then I read the tag. And I saw that it was from Elizabeth, the clerk whose checkout counter I had commandeered. I mean, she'd given me a gift, and it didn't make sense. I didn't deserve anything good from her. I acted like a Christmas maniac. And then I realized, you know, in Isaiah, it says, by his wounds, we are healed. And I think through my wounds, I've been healed of some things. You see, I was bound by religion, and I don't want to be bound any longer. You see, religion is wanting to be right, but grace is wanting to be right in the sight of others, but most importantly, in the sight of God. This season is about a baby who was born and grew to be the Messiah, the Christ, the God of the universe, extending his grace to us despite who we are, who we were, and who we will become. Despite what a mess we make of ourselves, what a gift. I don't know what's in this box. Maybe it's some more eggnog. Or maybe it's a Chia Pet nativity set. But I can tell you that the real gift is much better than either one of these.
While since we talked. I guess that's the way it is with your kids, though, right? You never get to talk as much as you like. Used to be a time when they'd hang at every word, every story, every joke, every little song. Wow, those were precious times. Those were amazing times, the laughter and the joy. Wow, how I miss those days. But then they got a little older, a little wiser, is how one of them put it. And he said he didn't know everything, but he did know one thing, that my ways, my values, and my philosophies on life were a little too, how do you put it? A little outdated? You just gotta laugh. Well, basically all they wanted was their freedom. And what was I to do? They're my kids. So I gave them what they wanted. And little by little, I watched them change. Push back against the things I taught them and lose heart. And they tried so hard to avoid me. And that's what bothered me the most. Oh, man, all I ever wanted was to have things right between us. So I kept doing things. I'd send letters. I'd call. I'd leave voicemails. I even sent messages to friends. But nothing. No response. I don't know, was it because they thought the distance between us was too great? Were they ashamed? You know, none of that really matters right now. You know, when they were kids, I used to tell them over and over again, I love you, no matter what. And it got to be a little thing between us. I'd say, I love you, and it would finish with, no matter what. They heard it so often that sometimes they would roll their eyes back when they'd say it. It was humorous. But you know, all I really wanted was to make it so clear to them that there was absolutely nothing they could do to make me stop loving them. You know that thing I'd say? It never stopped being true. So, I'm all packed up now and I'm ready to go. And I'm going to them. I'm not bringing any presents. No, not this time. Just the gift of making things right. There is nothing that will keep me from my kids. Not the past, not the future. Nothing in this universe that can separate me from the love that I have for my children. So, I'm forgetting about all that stuff in the past and all the relationship we used to have. Well, I'm not getting that anymore. And that's okay, because what I really want, what I'm really looking forward to, is a new relationship with my kids. After this trip, things will never be the same with us. And that's a good thing. New beginnings. I like the sound of that. That's what I'm all about. That's my hope for this Christmas. A new beginning with my kids.
It's from my husband, and I know what it is. I know because he told me right after we got married. He told me what he was going to get me on this Christmas. I guess I never thought this Christmas would get here. You see, I always knew I was meant to be a mother, and my husband was meant to be a dad. I just knew it. I was sure of it. Until I wasn't. It happened slowly at first. I didn't notice. After a while, the cute little jokes that our friends made, they stopped being funny. The constant pep talks from our family members reminded us that it just takes time. It started to become more defeating than encouraging. I mean, I thought, had I done something wrong? Am I being punished? I even convinced myself that somehow, some way, God had abandoned us in our pursuit of being parents. It's actually a little frightening to think of all the dark places my mind went to during those years. I thought, maybe if I'd have prayed more, trusted more, believed more, then maybe. But after years of praying and trusting and believing, I had nothing to show for it other than a broken heart and empty tissue boxes. We just learned to live with our broken hearts. It was just the way it was going to be. Until it wasn't. It was December 21st. I remember because I opened my advent calendar and there was an extra piece of chocolate in it. I love it when that happens. But that wasn't the best part. The best part was the scripture that came with the chocolate. Isaiah 61:1. The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is upon me because the Lord has chosen me. He has commissioned me to encourage the poor and to help the brokenhearted. You see, in this prophecy of the coming Messiah, God reassured us that not only had he not forgotten about us, but that he wanted to help us. Well, that little seed of hope found its way into my heart. And yes, God does have a strange way of doling out kids. But you see, we soon realized that we didn't necessarily have to experience the miracle of childbirth to experience the miracle of having a child. In my wildest dreams, I could never imagine how God would orchestrate this for us. But he did. He did it. You know, while our friends were off to Lamar's classes, we met with lawyers, social workers, and notaries. It took us a lot longer than 9 months to become parents. But this little guy, he was worth the wait. You know, just the other day, God reminds me that he provided baby Jesus in a very strange way on that very first Christmas. He didn't come like everybody thought he was going to show up. He also reminds me that because of baby Jesus, I am his adopted child. And if he loves me as much as I love this little guy, then I don't ever have to question his love for me again.
Oh, and the gift? It's from my husband's favorite football team for our son. But it's not gonna work because his favorite team is not my favorite team. And it's not your favorite team, is it? Either, is it? See, he doesn't want it.
Oh, hello, friends. I'm glad you're here. I've got a little Christmas story for you. You see this box? This box is a gift for my whole family. Let me back up a bit. You see, ours is a Christmas decorations goes up right after Thanksgiving dinner kind of family. You know the one. As soon as that leftover turkey and stuffing hits the Tupperware, man, it's lights out, ornaments up. Truth be told, we keep everything up, the tree, the lights, until about mid-January, late January at a minimum. Maybe we like having that Christmas atmosphere around all that time. Or maybe we're just lazy. There's a lot of ways that one can be lazy, you know. I mean, each year at Christmas, when it came to the routine of it, the tradition of it all, we were there. But sadly, when it came to Christ, our hearts had become lazy. See, part of the decorations is this here nativity set. And like everything else, we set it up very diligently, very deliberately, very matter-of-factly, very routinely. It was as if we were, trying to rush through just so that we could watch our favorite Christmas movies or think about going Black Friday shopping. After a while, I didn't like that, so I had an idea. Do you see this? Do you see what's missing? That's right. I stole baby Jesus. I plucked him right out of there. I started doing this about 4 years ago because I wanted him being there to mean something. So I kidnapped him. No, Messiah napped him? Wait, baby napped him. It doesn't matter. I took him. I put him in this box, and I hid him from my family. Now, I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, what? Why would a sane person hide baby Jesus from a nativity scene during Christmas? And folks, therein lies the problem. I'm not that sane. I've got four kids. Who could be sane with four kids? And B, for us, well, Jesus had become just an ornament. Another mindless tradition. And I didn't want that anymore for me or for my family. Man, I wish you would have been there that first year. The first year I did this, it was total bedlam. Where is he? Keep looking for him. Keep searching for him, my cherubs. Keep seeking him. Keep seeking him with all your heart. As you can see, the whereabouts of baby Jesus was at the forefront of everyone's mind. Each night, we'd follow new clues. I'd put out clues. The kids would follow up on needs. When my wife laid out dinner, we'd talk about where he might be. Is he upstairs? Is he downstairs? Could it be outside? Is he in the basement? Is he in the backyard? I have no idea. I don't know. Folks, for 4 weeks during the Christmas season, our house was completely soaked in conspiracy. It was awesome. Now, I know I'm not the brightest bulb on the Christmas tree. You can tell. But I do know one thing. I'm smart enough to know that there's nothing more important than seeking Christ, especially at Christmas. So that's why I hide them. By the way, as you saw, my kids are totally into this. 2 years ago, they made up t-shirts that said, "Keep calm, find Jesus." Last year, my girls made up a Facebook page. Can you believe that? So since we do this over and over, like hide and seek during the holiday, during the Christmas season, do you want to know the last place they found him? I hid him by the live Christmas tree. The clue that did it was Ephesians 5:2. It talks about how Christ gave himself up as a fragrant offering, a fragrant offering in sacrifice unto God. Fragrant offering. It took them a while, but eventually they got it. I don't know, keep looking. You're getting close. Fragrant offering. Think about a fragrant offering. Where could it be? You got him! Yay! All right. Aren't they the cutest things? And by the way, because of this whole thing, they think I still got it. By the way, now that they found him, I've got to hide him again. No. He's got to stay hidden until Christmas Eve. See, because on Christmas Eve, my wife dims the lights, puts on candles. We shut off the televisions, the cell phones, the iPads, everything. And our house is just quiet. Christ came into this world very quietly, very humbly. I want my family to experience this moment, to really absorb it and take it in. And then, and only then, we'll open up this gift for good. This amazing, wonderful, God-breathed, prophecy-fulfilling gift. We'll set him properly on the manger, and we'll talk about how Jesus Christ is the greatest gift ever, period. Friends, Jeremiah 29:13 says that when you seek me, you will find me when you seek me with all of your heart. And that's all I want for my family. See, for us, during Christmas, this is a simple way to keep the main thing, Jesus. I mean, I want that for me too. Folks, our ancestors had waited hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years for this Messiah to be born. So I ask you, what's just a few weeks for us? Anyway, gotta go back out and hide him again. Thank you, Lord. Man, I love doing this.
Different stories. Well, Merry Christmas. I didn't feel the love there. Merry Christmas. Praise God. Amen. What is the true meaning of Christmas? As you saw the five different stories, short skits, we all have a story. What is the true meaning of Christmas? Is it the sleigh bells, the reindeers, snow falling, icicles forming, Christmas music? I got to make a confession. And don't hate on me when I make this confession. I don't like Christmas music. I kind of like Grandma Got Run Over by a Reindeer. That's pretty cool. But other than that, Christmas lights, Christmas trees, Christmas presents, shopping, planning, cooking, eating, visiting friends and family. Is that what Christmas is all about? But saints, let's be honest. Somewhere, sometimes in the midst of all the hustle and the bustle of the holiday season and the festivities and the running around, quite often the real meaning of Christmas is lost. Let's not forget, church, Jesus is the reason for the season. Whether it's a young man at home in a wheelchair, praise God, or or baby Jesus being hid by a father of four. And he was right. Nobody can keep their sanity who has four children. I got four girls. I saw my girls there. Hey, where are my girls? Any of my girls? Oh, there they go in the back. I take that back. I love you guys. Amen. It goes beyond, Christmas goes beyond the sweet story of a baby born in a stable. Rachel read it earlier as we started the service. Luke chapter 2, verses 10 and 11 says, the shepherds were terrified, but the angel reassured them, don't be afraid. I bring you good news that will bring great joy to all people. The Savior. How many praise the Savior? Yes, the Messiah, the Lord, has been born today in Bethlehem, the city of David. Christmas is about the Savior of all people. The shepherds were afraid, and we live in a world full of anxiety and fear. And saints, it's not the politics of the day that fills us with fear. The problem with humanity is a sin problem. Can somebody say amen to that? And terror and fear is a result of our sin problem. Sin was the problem when Christ was born, and sin is the problem today. The Bible says that we all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. It's the deceit that's in our heart, the heart of man, that strikes fear. But thank God for the good news. Can somebody say amen? Thank God for the good news of the Christmas message that has brought joy to all that will receive the grace of God in their lives. It's a universal message. Regardless of who you are, the message, the good news is for you. God is no respecter of persons. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Christmas is about a sin problem, and the message and the good news is that Christ, the Savior, was born in a lonely manger in order to save humanity. The Savior was born in order to die for every one of us. Our sins have us bound. But the good news is that Christ, the Christ that was born, died so that we can be set free. How many set free people do we have here today? Amen? You can't save yourself. You need a Savior. And Christmas is about the gift of salvation that has been freely given to all. Can somebody say amen to that? That's what Christmas is all about. That's what was reflected. That's the message that we wanted to convey this evening about the gift of Christmas, is that baby Jesus being born in that stable, growing sinless life and giving his life for every one of us. We deserve the punishment of sin. But there was a great exchange on the cross. Amen. That he that was innocent took upon him all the sins of the world, everything that you have done, every sin that you have committed, every sin that you will commit. Jesus took it on the cross. That's the message. And I love Pastor Pablo's little skit. Yeah, thank God for happy holidays, but Merry Christmas to all. It's about the risen Christ that died for every one of us. So tonight we want to thank all the visitors, and you're here for the very first time coming out to see the play. But we can't leave this evening without making an invitation to everyone that's here. We want to make sure that everyone here has received that message and has made a difference in your life. So if everybody would be so kind to just bow your heads, and everyone with their eyes closed, if there is anyone here, the greatest gift of all is the Christ that died for us. But if there's anyone here that has not made a decision to surrender their hearts to Christ, please, every head bowed and every eye closed, or you want to renew your faith, and yeah, you're getting caught up in the running around and getting caught up in the holiday season as projected by the world. And you may be saying, Pastor, somewhere along the way, I just lost sight of what Christmas, the Christmas season is all about. And I want to rededicate my life to that risen Savior. If that is you this evening, with every head bowed, please just raise your hand. If anybody, I see that hand, amen. If anybody just wants to rededicate their life and or give their life to the Lord, just raise your hand. It's between you and God. Remember, you can't save yourself. You need a Savior. Receiving Christ is a matter of faith. Believing that he died for you, he took your place. Once again, that great exchange on the cross. He who was innocent took upon himself the sins of the world. Once again, if you want to receive Christ into your life or just rededicate yourself, all those that raise your hand, keep your hands raised. And anyone else, just raise your hands right now in the name of Jesus. Amen. This is a sacred moment. It's between you and God. Praise God. We thank God for those hands raised. And please, church, why don't we all just, with your heads bowed and your eyes closed, just repeat after me. Everyone, help those that raise their hands. Church, I know you made this this prayer. You've said this prayer before. Just say it again and just repeat after me. Father, come on, church. Father, I know that I have broken your laws and I have sinned. I acknowledge that I am a sinner. Please forgive me. I believe that your son Jesus died for my sins and resurrected from the dead. I thank you for taking my place. And tonight I invite you to become the Lord of my life. I believe this good news, the message of the cross. Please forgive me, Lord. I receive you now into my heart. I am a new creation in Christ. I have been forgiven. Lord, I thank you for my salvation. In Jesus' name, amen. If you made that prayer and you did it with all your heart, today you have been transformed from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light. Come on. Praise God. That's what it's all about. Praise God. I don't know about you, but I was glad to be in the house of the Lord. Those that did raise your hand afterward will be here at the altar. Please come in to greet us. We want to know who you are. We want to pray with you in Jesus' name. Can we please stand, church? Praise God. Once again, I just want to thank you, Eric, for the wonderful job. Praise God. Everyone, thank you, all the visitors. Praise God. The Lord really is good. Hallelujah. Glory to God.